It has to do with agriculture and environmental science.
Hello, okay. For the students in the presentation booths, please, at this time, our dean is on stage. We are supposed to be seated. I want to encourage you that you shouldn't go to any lab. Dean has said there shouldn't be any lab this afternoon. So what you're going to do, everybody listen, you're to move from where you are and just come. You can leave two persons in your space if you have not been assessed. If you have been assessed already, up to three persons have assessed you, you can come forward and sit down, please, so that we can have a productive afternoon. Thank you. And those who were asked to remove their stuff for somebody to come to your space, you can remove them, okay? If you were not asked to remove your stuff, you can leave them, especially those on the wall. Leave them. It helps for the presentation and the conference. Those who have space that they ask you to take off your stuff, you could take them off and then come and sit. Thank you. Our dean is on stage. So please stop the talking and come. Thank you, sir.
Yes. We have a number. Yes. Okay, yes, as stated, this afternoon is very important because we are dealing with agriculture, which has to do with food security, and all of us here, we rely on what? Food. And the second aspect is the environment. Right now, we are faced with serious environmental challenges. Climate change is at the door and the lips of everyone. So we are going to be discussing this afternoon agriculture and the environment. We realize that some of the persons are not here as yet, but we are going to start because we have to stick to time. This afternoon we are going to start out with Professor Max Wellington. He's a lecturer in the Department of Biology, Chemistry, and Environmental Science. Professor Wellington will speak about zinc mineralogy and the processing of Jamaica bauxite in a high-temperature alumina refinery. Professor Wellington, welcome. Could you put your hands together for Professor Wellington?
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. The title of my presentation, as Professor Wright mentioned, is The Zinc Mineralogy and the Processing of Jamaican Bauxite in a High-Temperature Alumina Refinery. Now, the map of Jamaica that you see on the screen, the shaded regions indicate just the areas where we have bauxite left in Jamaica. And currently we have about 2 billion metric tons of bauxite reserves in the country. Okay, thanks. 2 billion metric tons of bauxite in reserve. And this, and this could probably give us another 50 years of the bauxite alumina industry in Jamaica. However, this, the title of this section is Environment, and I'd just like to mention that a large proportion of the good bauxite, we have bad bauxite and we have good bauxite. The good bauxite resides in the cockpit country, and the cockpit country is a protected area, and so they are unable to mine that bauxite at this time. Okay, I want to give you some definitions as before I go into the presentation. First of all, we're going to be talking about the Bayer process. And the Bayer process is a process that was developed by Carl Bayer in 1888. And this process is used to process alumina, to extract alumina from bauxite. Now, prior to 1888, alumina was considered a precious metal because it was very difficult to purify alumina. But since this process was developed by a scientist, alumina became a commodity, and so it's no longer a precious metal. Another definition I want to talk about is gibbsite. There are two types of bauxites found in Jamaica. We have gibbsite, which is a trihydrate alumina. It has three water of crystallizations in the alumina molecule, so it's Al2O3.3H2O. And we have boehmite, which is a monohydrate bauxite. Now, these bauxites, although they have similar chemical formulas, the extraction process for each one is very different. For the monohydrate bauxite, you have to use high-temperature alumina refining. You have to heat the bauxite in the caustic to about 240 degrees centigrade. For the trihydrate, you can extract at 140 degrees centigrade. So you can see there's a big energy difference between the two plants. And there's only one high-energy plant in Jamaica, and that's Alumina Partners of Jamaica, which is now called GISCO. The other definitions, BOT, or blow-off tank, and the settler overflow, I will discuss as we look at the diagrams below. Yes. Okay. So this diagram is a flow diagram of the Bayer process. And we start off with the digestion. Here the bauxite is introduced into the caustic and heated to 140 degrees for trihydrate or 240 for monohydrate. It boils in there like a pressure cooker for a little while. Thereafter, the alumina would enter into the caustic, the liquor. Right, so the alumina is in the liquor, and all the other impurities, which is the iron, the titanium, the silica, etc., would be in the mud. And we settle the mud in the clarification circuit, which is a step two, leaving the liquor purified from all the solids. The purified liquor at this stage, which is called pregnant liquor, then is then sent to the precipitation circuit, where the alumina in the liquor is precipitated, collected and dried, and that is calcined at 1,100 degrees to remove the water of crystallization from the alumina, and then it is shipped to wherever in the world the alumina is destined for. Okay, this slide is a little more detailed. So here we have the same process, but we have some more details added. Here we have a ball mill. So the bauxite will go through the ball mill to be ground up to a size of less than a half inch. Then it goes to a holding tank with caustic at 100 degrees centigrade, where it stays for an hour. And then it goes to the flash tanks, which is like a pressure cooker, which heats the bauxite up to the required temperature using steam, pressurized steam. So we heat it to 240 degrees for monohydrate, 140 for trihydrate. But in this presentation, we'll be talking about high temperature plants. So we are talking about the extraction of monohydrate. After the alumina is digested into the liquor, we have to cool down the solution. How we can send this hot solution through the process. So we have a blow-off tank where it cools the solution to a little above 100 degrees centigrade. The steam is not wasted. It is collected and used to reheat other areas of the process. And then it goes from the blow-off tank to the clarification circuit, where the settling of the mud takes place, and the liquor will rise to the top. The liquor, which is basically particle-free, is then passed through a filter press to remove any remaining particles, like small particles of mud or zinc sulfide and so forth, and then it is sent to the precipitation circuit, where it is seeded for precipitation into the alumina product, which is then calcined and sent exported. These are the equations that show the reactions that take place. So the alumina will be digested in the caustic to form sodium aluminate, iron and so forth, silica. Iron doesn't react with it, so those remain in the mud. The zinc also reacts with this, with the caustic, which is a problem, because when the zinc reacts with the caustic, it ends up in the precipitation circuit and it ends up as a part of the alumina product. And nobody wants alumina with high zinc content. The alumina is very fragile and it cannot be extruded into aluminum foil or to make motor vehicles and so forth. So the zinc content has to be kept at a, has to be properly controlled. Okay. We have five different processing plants in Jamaica for bauxite and alumina. Alpart, with a capacity of 1.6 million tons. Kirkvine and Newarton, both Windalco, 1.3 million tons. Jamalco, 1.4. And Noranda, which only deals with bauxite, 3.1 million tons in 2008. In 2008, the bauxite alumina industry contributed 12% of GDP, or $1.65 billion US dollars. In 2017, there was a significant drop because of the reduced production to 5% of GDP, or US $739 million. In terms of country, in 1971, Jamaica was the top alumina bauxite producing country in the world. A lot of people didn't know that. But today, we are like at number 6 in the world in terms of bauxite production. We have been overtaken by Australia and China and Guinea, which has the largest bauxite reserves in the world, 7.4 billion metric tons, has the best bauxite in the world. It's low in zinc, low in a lot of the impurities that will contaminate the Bayer process. In terms of alumina production, Jamaica has also fallen. The lead producer of alumina in the world is now China, with 72.3 million tons per year. Australia right behind with 20.6, and Jamaica down at 2 million tons per year. The price of alumina varies. It's a commodity, and the price depends on the price of the metal. So as you can see with this graph here, it shows the London Metal Exchange price of alumina metal in red, and the gray is the price of the alumina that we export, the white powder. So it really follows closely. So when aluminum prices fall, the alumina prices fall. Currently, alumina prices are at one of the highest they have ever been, $430 per ton, right? So with Alpart making 1.6 million tons per year, they would be earning almost $700 million for the year from that. Okay, let's skip this one. Oh, let's talk about the challenges to the bauxite industry are many. For this particular presentation, will be focused mainly on the issue of quality of bauxite and quantity. Well, quality of bauxite, and we'll be talking about the zinc levels, and also alumina product quality. If your alumina quality isn't good, you're not going to get any people want to buy it. Anybody want to buy your alumina? And you're going to have to sell it cheaper than you ought to. All right. The objectives of this presentation are, one, to quantify zinc levels in bauxite feed, pregnant liquor and alumina product in high-temperature refinery, to investigate the use of sulfide in the removal of zinc from pregnant liquor prior to precipitation as a means of reducing zinc levels in the product alumina, and to validate the need for assessing zinc levels as a quality assurance parameter in product alumina. So those are our objectives for this presentation. By way of introduction, zinc is found in alumina. It's a secondary metal. It's found karst bauxites, which are bauxites that are derived from limestone. Typical of the bauxites found in Jamaica, tend to be very high in zinc, in contrast to lateritic bauxites, which are found in Europe and other parts of the world. High zinc in Jamaican bauxite, which ranges from about 0.02 to 0.1%, is also found in bauxites in the Russian or Balkan regions and in some of the Chinese bauxites. Zinc in bauxites occur in several minerals. It occurs in garnet, which is a zinc aluminate, sphalerite, lithosphorite, zincophorite, woodruffite, and it's also associated with goethite and hematite, which are iron ores. High zinc levels is undesirable in bauxite, as the zinc is soluble in the beer liquor. It will react with the sodium hydroxide, so it will be consuming some of your sodium hydroxide that was destined to extract alumina, and it will remain in the liquor and end up in your product alumina. Zinc level limits in product alumina is very low. It should be no more than 0.013%, and this would lead to a zinc level in your aluminum metal of 0.02%. Zinc is dangerous to the Bayer process because it reduces the current efficiency during electrolysis, and it is detrimental to the quality of the metal, making it fragile and unsuitable for extrusion to make foil and to make Venetian blinds and motor vehicles, etc. All right, in order to reduce the zinc levels in the Bayer process, sodium sulfide is used, and the sodium sulfide will react with the zinc to produce zinc sulfide, which will precipitate out, and it can be removed during filtration. So sodium sulfide is used to remove zinc. It has some drawbacks, though. The sodium sulfide, the unreacted one, will cause corrosion of the pipes of the Bayer process, and also you can have scaling of the pipes. And the sulfide oxidizes to produce sulfate in the process with each turn of the process. And the sulfate will cause the size of the alumina particles to get very fine. And nobody wants the alumina to purchase when it's too fine. They want the 10 micron size to be more than 10%. No more than 10% of your alumina. Another issue is with high temperature plants, zinc tends to absorb a lot more easily in the liquor. So you get higher absorption of zinc in the Bayer liquor with high temperature plants. With a low temperature plant like Windalco, which operates at 140 degrees, they don't have a problem with zinc in their alumina because the zinc doesn't digest into the liquor. It remains with the mud. Okay. This chart is showing you typical composition of a typical bauxite and composition of an alumina sample that was made according to specification, right? So over here, typical bauxite, 47% alumina. In the alumina that we export, we want about at least 98.4%. Zinc in the bauxite is 0.02, And in the product alumina, we don't want it to be more than 0.012. Yes. So if it goes above that, you might have a problem. Some of the smelters may not want to purchase your aluminum. Okay, for our experiment, we use several methods, X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy, X-ray diffraction and chromatography, atomic absorption spectrometry, infrared thermogravimetry, and we use alumina caustic soda analysis using the Metrom autotire traters. The first slide shows the distribution of zinc and manganese in the bauxite that was supplied to the alumina plant over a period of 20 months. So each parameter represents a monthly composite. And here we see the average composition of zinc in the bauxite fed to the plant or processed by the plant over that 20-month period was 0.02%, and the manganese levels were about 0.36%, right? We then did a scatter plot to show, this one shows the XDB analysis of a bauxite sample. XDB is a integrated analysis of X-ray fluorescence and X-ray diffraction, which are then integrated using the XDB software, applying mass balances to get a phase composition, which is a little more accurate than the XRF by itself. And here we saw that the composition of zinc was very similar to what we got with the XRF. So there was no question about those results that we got. All right, this one is showing you the zinc versus manganese. I think I missed up. Oh, this is a scatter plot showing the relationship of zinc and manganese in the bauxite. And we got a very low linear regression, which showed that there was a very poor relationship. There were some researchers that said there was a very close relationship, but in the bauxites that we analyzed, we saw that the relationship was very poor, which is indicative that the manganese and the zinc present in our bauxite may be supplied by many different ores, different types of ores. The next slide is showing you the zinc and manganese in the mud. So after we extract the alumina from the bauxite, we saw that the manganese levels went up to 0.86 from 0.36. So most of the manganese left the plant in the mud. So if you go to the mud lake and analyze the mud there, you'd find about 0.86% manganese. The zinc levels in the mud were still pretty low, 0.02 and 3, and so most of the zinc remained in the liquor, in the beer liquor. This shows the relationship between zinc and manganese in the alumina product. And here we see that we were able to control the zinc using sulfide down to the specified levels of 0.0012% using sulfide and zincate. The manganese levels in the product was very low, 0.001%, which is well within specification. Zinc removal from the beer liquors using sulfide. Here we are using sulfide, 76.5 gram per liter sulfide. And after 15 minutes, we got 87.2% removal of zinc. Thereafter, the zinc was started to reabsorb into the liquor. So we were getting reversion. So after 15 minutes, there was reversion of the amount of zinc that was extracted. So we decided to try it with zincate. So we, in addition to sulfide, we applied zincate, which is a sodium zincate solution, and we got better removal from the beer liquor, and there was even less reversion. If you notice the brown plots, there is hardly any reversion, whereas in the blue plots, we got reversion with the sulfide. Okay. This was zinc removal from another liquor in the plant, from the settler overflow. And this liquor is at a much lower temperature than the blow-off tank. And as you can see, the removal is a little slower because of the lower temperature, but it's constant and consistent. So this provides another avenue for zinc removal. Sulfur enters the process not only by the sulfide that we add to remove zinc, but sulfur also enters the process by sulfide, which is present in the bauxite. And this sulfide is present in the bauxite at 0.13%. The sulfide is converted to sulfate in the process, and as you can see, analysis of the liquor is very high in sulfate, and sulfate, if it gets too high, it's very bad for the process. It results in fines being produced and corrosion of the pipes. All right, this is just IC chromatogram from the IC. So in conclusion, Jamaican bauxites are relatively high in zinc content, which presents challenges to alumina production. Zinc in Jamaican bauxites emanate from several ores, chief of which appears to be zincophorite and woodruffite, which both also contain manganese. Zinc is soluble in bare liquor and will report to the alumina product, whereas manganese is largely insoluble and most of it is removed with the mud. Zinc has to be removed. Its removal increases production cost and thereby reduces refinery profitability. Sulfide can be used to effectively remove zinc from the bare process liquors to control zinc content in product alumina to within acceptable limits. Sulfide, when used in conjunction with zincate solution, however, was shown to be more effective. Additionally, 50% of the sulfate in plant liquors emanate from the oxidation of residual sulfides in the process. The other 50% comes from sulfur in the bauxite. Sulfate negatively impacts precipitation efficiency, reduces profitability. Therefore, sulfide use has to be properly controlled. Also, the zinc content of the bauxite inputs to the process has to be properly monitored and controlled. Alumina refineries that process low zinc bauxites have a competitive advantage. And our recommendations, we recommend evaluation and testing of different zinc removal models. There are several patents available for zinc removal from the bare process, especially for high zinc bauxites. Two, assess the impact of sulfur, copper, and lead in bauxite and zinc removal in the bare process, as this could lead to improved mass balances with zinc sulfide and improved process control. And lastly, assess the use of lime and other additives in reducing processed liquor sulfates. Acknowledgements. I'd like to acknowledge Almighty God, Alumina Partners of Jamaica, now known as JISCO, Jiguan Iron and Steel Company, Northern Caribbean University, Dr. Michael Coley, Huey, Robert Finlayson, JISCO, and Damian Banton from Thermo Fisher. These are the references, and that's the end. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Wellington. We are going to ask you to keep your question to the end of the period, whereby you will ask your questions. At this time, we have with us Dr. Hansel Fletcher from Loma Linda University. He's an assistant dean, the graduate student affairs, and vice chair for the Department of Basic Medical Science at Loma Linda University. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to put your hands together to welcome Dr. Hansel Fletcher.
Well, thanks for the introduction, and I'm really very happy to be here to share with you some of what we've done over the years. And I'd like to talk to us today about overcoming environmental stress, survival strategies. And I just wanted to start off this talk by thanking some of those in my lab. Some are present and future, all in this picture, who have contributed to some of the research that I will be talking about. I have quite a crew that has generated some of this data that I will talk to you about today. I'll focus this talk on the oral cavity. And as our paradigm, we'll look at some of the microorganisms that we find in the oral ecosystem that's associated with periodontal disease. In the oral cavity, we have over close to 700 different bacterial species in the microbiome, and their interaction can certainly impact the host and is associated with certain types of diseases. In this particular case, we have several microorganisms that's involved with periodontal disease, and we've been studying two of these diseases over the years. This is one microorganism, Parafomonas gingivalis, and also another a microorganism, Philofactolosis, which I'll be talking about today, that's associated with periodontal disease. When we look at the interaction that occurs in the oral cavity associated with periodontal disease, we can go from a healthy state to a disease state where you look at the gums, they're quite healthy here, and over here in periodontal disease, you get a breakdown in the underlying tissue, also the bone tissue, and this is also triggered partly by the host, and hopefully I'll convince you that these microbes also play a role in that. And of course, there are several factors that come together that will impact this disease. So certainly we have microbes that will be part of this, the host genetics, because some people are more susceptible to this disease. And of course, the environment determined by some nutrients and the general state of that environment. And of course, at this intersection is where we see the disease. So it's impacted or it's influenced by the microbes, the environment, and of course, the host genetics. When we look at the host-microbe interaction that causes this disease, and this disease is an inflammatory type disease where the host does respond to the accumulation of bacteria on the surface of the teeth. It starts off by colonization, and that colonization results in microcolonies that mature to form these biofilms. And these biofilm, which is a mature biofilm community, will trigger a response from the host, and it can also induce damage. So the host responds by producing macrophages, neutrophils. Of course, you have antibodies being produced by these plasma cells. And it's this response here that can also cause damage to the tissue, resulting in periodontal disease, or this mature biofilm community certainly can induce damage. Because this is a microbiome community, and the host interacts with the host, one of the organisms I will describe to you is this one here. It's in green, which is Parafomonas gingivalis. And of course, it interacts with Philofactolosis, which is a gram-positive anaerobe. We'll come back and talk a little bit more about that. But with Parafomonas gingivalis, it causes inflammation by inflammation and bone loss by remodeling the oral commensal microbiota. So this organism, it can present in small, in very low concentrations, but it's considered a keystone pathogen, and part of its characteristics, it can manage and it can manipulate the oral microenvironment. Of course, it can impair host immunity because it's one of the most proteolytic organisms we have, which it can certainly degrade complement, and complement is certainly part of the innate immune response. It can also degrade antibodies. And by doing this, it will impede the immune response where the microbiota gets out of control. So we have a dysbiotic microbiota. Is this in focus? Can we focus it a little better, please? We have dysbiotic microbiota. So these organisms will grow out of control because, of course, the host immune response is no longer able to keep them in check. By growing out of control, of course, you get more induction of complement. You get inflammation. That inflammation can impact the host, resulting in bone loss, also tissue breakdown. And, of course, you have a periodontal pocket. You have a new niche being formed, more micronutrients, and this continues in this cycle. And Parvovirus gingivalis, which I told you is a keystone pathogen, can certainly direct this kind of activity. Because periodontal disease is an inflammatory disease, this organism is also faced with an oxidative stress environment. Because these neutrophils will produce hydrogen peroxide. And one of the things that we did earlier on was to see how the organism responds to oxidative stress. And we simulated that by using hydrogen peroxide, 0.25 millimolar hydrogen peroxide, to look to see how this organism responded to stress. And we can see at different time points the amount of stress that is certainly very different. At early stage, in about 10 minutes, a lot of genes involved in DNA repair is upregulated, and later on, about 15 minutes, a lot model that we propose that describes how this organism responds to stress. So there are several different ways. This organism also produces a pigmented layer, which is made up of hemin, and this hemin layer can degrade the hydrogen peroxide. Also, there are other mechanisms where it can repair protein damage, or it can also repair DNA. And we're not exactly sure what mechanism is being used. It just uses a unique mechanism that we're actually trying to study in terms of trying to understand how it repairs DNA that's damaged under oxidative stress. And there are several antioxidant proteins that are involved in the detoxification process that will help it to survive. And that is also regulated by several transcriptional regulators that can respond to oxidative stress. One of the genes that's being upregulated when we expose hydrogen, Parvovirus gingivalis to hydrogen peroxide is a unique protein, which is, P0686, is induced in PG under conditions of hydrogen peroxide induced stress. This protein has several domains, one domain of unknown function. It has a PAS domain. It also has a hemerythrin domain. But the function of this protein is certainly unknown. And we have a graduate student who is now trying to characterize this protein. And it is shown that this, when we inactivate this gene in Parvovirus gingivalis, as you can see here in this mutant, it's extremely sensitive to oxidative stress. And here we're looking at percent survival, where we expose the cells to hydrogen peroxide, And then we plate the viable cells, looking at viable cells. And you can see the wild type has about a little over 50% survival, while this mutant is less than 5% survival to oxidative stress, which suggests that this gene is certainly important in allowing it to survive. This particular gene is also, when we looked at the transcriptional profiling of this particular mutant, we're showing that several genes are being affected when we inactivate this gene. And one I'll just point out is right here, this is a gene, rubritrin, which is reduced, its expression is reduced more than sixfold in this mutant when you inactivate PG686. And this rubritrin is involved in hydrogen peroxide resistance or oxidative stress resistance. We see that this particular gene does regulate the expression of this gene. We also see where it affects the expression of under oxidative stress. If you should stress that mutant, you'll also notice that this rubritrin gene, which is significantly downregulated by more than 17-fold, which suggests that this particular gene regulates some of the genes that will allow oxidative stress resistance in this in Performonas. What it turns out to be is that this gene, we're getting some preliminary data, that is a diguanylate cyclase. Very unique because it doesn't have some of the conserved regions for this diguanylate cyclase. Whether it's a new category of diguanylate cyclase, we're not sure. But this diguanylate cyclase, and this is the assay that is we're using to suggest, and this is just a preliminary study suggesting that this particular gene has diguanylate cyclase activity. Now, diguanylate cyclase activity is important as a secondary messenger system where you have cyclic diGMP, which is a global bacterial second messenger that will control a wide range of cellular functions. This cyclic diGMP controls cellular processes at both the transcriptional, translational, and post-translational levels through an interaction of an increasing number of diguanylate GMP binding proteins and also ribose switches. And that's one of the mechanisms we're still trying to understand. And as I've shown you earlier, it can regulate the expression of some of these genes involved with oxidative stress in this organism. So when we look at what a model for cyclic diGMP signaling, of course you have a diguanylate cyclase that will generate this diGMP, and this diGMP can bind to receptors, whether it's transcriptional factors, ribose switch, and specific proteins, and can regulate several cell cycle function, whether it's biofilm activity, motility, virulence, or cell cycle. So it's likely that this particular protein is important in regulating some of the genes that are involved in oxidative stress resistance. As a regulator, there are also other regulators that we know that will modify or will allow this organism to adapt to oxidative stress. And several of them are known, some are not known. We have some here. For example, we have an extracytoplasmic function sigma factor that's involved, and these extracytoplasmic function sigma factor operates in a very unique way, where in this case, it can be impacted by the environment. It is in at least in Bacillus subtilis, this sigma factor is released. It's processed by an enzyme, it then joins to the RNA polymerase, and it brings about the expression of this specific gene that might be needed to respond to oxidative stress. There's also another mechanism where we can get phosphorylation, it causes the extracytoplasmic function sigma factor to be released, and it brings about the expression of particular RNA that is important for oxidative stress resistance. These extracytoplasmic function sigma factor in Perth gingivalis seem to function in a very similar way. And one of the ones that we've studied is PG1660, which when inactivated under oxidative stress, is very sensitive to oxidative stress. When we expose it to hydrogen peroxide, it's very sensitive in this particular mutant. Of course, when we looked at the genes that are being associated with this particular sigma factor, there are several genes that will allow this organism to respond to oxidative stress that's being modulated. There is also another mechanism which we think is quite unique, and this one we're still trying to understand, where this organism, it does not make cysteine, and cysteine is an amino acid that's significant in producing some of the virulence factors in this organism. For example, it's proteases. Remember I told you earlier, it's a very proteolytic organism. This cysteine can also respond, can also play some role in oxidative stress. So when we have cysteine, if we oxidize cysteine, we get cysteine, or reduce the cysteine, we get cysteine. And this can occur and also play a role in how the organism responds to oxidative stress. One of the genes that we discovered that's highly upregulated when we expose this organism to oxidative stress is this 1668 and also 1663, which seem to have some homology with a transporter that's involved in transporting cysteine and cysteine across the cell, so it can go through that cycle. And what we've seen is when we inactivate this gene, which is 1663, that particular mutant is very sensitive to oxidative stress. And what we need to determine, and which is not yet complete, is whether or not this hypothesis is correct, where it acts as a transporter, where we get it reduced, we get it reduced and oxidized, and by going between cysteine and cysteine, the organism can more easily adapt to oxidative stress. There are also other mechanisms that Perfumolus gingivalis can use, and one of which is interacting with other organisms. So by interacting, and remember now, this organism is in a biofilm. When you think about it, it doesn't grow by itself. We don't have pure cultures of any particular microbe, let's say, in any environment. There's a community, and you get that kind of interaction. And we're trying to, there's new data which suggests that Perfumonas gingivalis, which is part of the oral microbiome, can interact with many different other microbes, one of which is Filofactolosis, which is one we started studying fairly recent, which is a gram-positive organism, which is found in high concentrations in individuals with periodontal disease. And this organism has some unique characteristics. What we've discovered is that we have a Filofactolosis-centered co-occurrence group associated with periodontal disease. So anywhere you see Filofactor, you're going to see Perfumonas gingivalis in patients that they've looked at. This Filofactor is a gram-positive asarcolytic obligate anaerobe. It was first isolated in 1985, and it's present in very high concentrations in the periodontal pocket, and it's least detected, or it's almost undetected, in healthy or periodontitis-resistant patients. We were one of the first groups to show that this organism has several virulence properties that will allow it to be classified as a periodontal pathogen, one of which it can form biofilm. So here we see Perfumonas gingivalis, which can form biofilm. We also see Filofactolosis, which can form biofilm. If they interact together, that biofilm formation is enhanced. So there is some synergy when those two organisms interact, which can allow it to form better biofilms. So in order for pathogenic bacteria to successfully colonize the host, it must be able to adhere and also invade host cells. And we're showing that Perfumonis gingivalis, its adherence, and we're using epithelial cells in this example, can be enhanced with co-infection with Filofactylosis. So looking at how it adheres to cells, here is Perfumonis gingivalis, in this case W83. Here is Filofactylosis. They can adhere, but together we see where this activity is certainly enhanced, and it is very significant. So by co-culturing them and infecting them on this epithelial cells, we see an increase in how these cells can adhere. Also, we see an increase in how these cells can invade. So when we look at the percent invasion, we see where Perfumonis gingivalis can invade, we see where Filofactylosis can invade, but in co-culture, we see that activity is certainly increased, which suggests that there is some synergy between these organisms. Here is a electron microgram showing of co-infection of Filofacta with Perfumonis gingivalis. It causes the membranes to ruffle. Here we have Filofactylosis. Here we have Perfumonis gingivalis. When you co-infect, you see these cells ruffle, as opposed to mono-infection. When they're infected with Filofactylosis, you see how the cells still remain, has a smooth surface. Even though the cells die when they break apart when you co-infect them with this, with both Filofactor and Perfumonis gingivalis. This is also an example of Perfumonis gingivalis in mono-infection. The cells also have a smooth surface, but the cells can also die in the presence of Filofactylosis. But it shows that the host cells certainly respond very differently. The host cells respond very differently when we co-infect. Filofactor, which is quite interesting for us, appeared to be more resistant to hydrogen peroxide. Because remember, in that inflammatory microenvironment, it responds very differently to hydrogen peroxide. And here is just a simple experiment where we're exposing the cells to hydrogen peroxide. And here is W83. So we expose the cells for about 30 minutes to hydrogen peroxide, and we're looking at percent survival. We get about a 10%, less than a 10% survival of Perfumonis gingivalis, as opposed to over about a 60% survival of Filofactylosis, which suggests that Filofactylosis is certainly more resistant than Perfumonis gingivalis to oxidative stress. When we put them together in co-culture, and we expose them for different lengths of time, and we're looking at percent survival, we see where Perfumonis gingivalis, after a 30-minute exposure, we see where they survive a lot better in the presence of Filofactylosis. And what we're showing here is, in this blue, is without in monoculture, and what we're showing here is in the presence of Filofactor. And at different time points, we see that we're getting a lot better survival of Perfumonis gingivalis in co-culture with Filofactor, as opposed to by itself. In this experiment, we're asking the question, is there something from Filofactor, because Filofactor is more resistant, more relatively resistant than Perfumonis gingivalis. In this experiment, we're asking, is there something that Filofactor is giving off that will break down the hydrogen peroxide, or is there a phenotype that is being induced by Filofactor? And what we're showing here, when we looking at percent survival, when we expose Perfumonis gingivalis in monoculture to hydrogen peroxide, at least we're seeing this almost 10% survival. If we expose, if we do it in co-culture, and here we grow filofactor, we take the pellet, we mix it with W83, the perfumilus gingivalis, and then we expose it, we see where we're getting we're getting increased survival. If we just take the supernatant, which means you grow the cells up, you expose them to hydrogen peroxide, you take the supernatant, and you add it to perfumilus gingivalis, there's something that is being secreted that will break down the hydrogen peroxide or it will induce it. We're seeing that the level of sensitivity is pretty much the same both here and here, which suggests that perfumilus gingivalis has to interact with filofactor allosis in order to become more resistant to oxidative stress. There are several other mechanisms that we're starting to look at in filofactor allosis, and one of the questions we ask, there are some genes that we know of that's involved with oxidative stress that's missing in filofactor, but one of the genes that's involved that we see in filofactor is the superoxide reductase, and we inactivated that gene and asked the question, what does it look like if you expose, if you inactivate this reductase, what does it look like when you expose it to oxidative stress? And here is the wild type filofactor exposed to hydrogen peroxide, which is fairly resistant. And when we inactivate the superoxide reductase in filofactor allosis, we see where sensitivity is certainly increased, where it's less sensitive to hydrogen peroxide. So at 2 hours, there's no survival. And this one, this is what occurs, this is what occurs in air. And this is what occurs when you expose it to hydrogen peroxide. So this one occurs in air, where it's more air sensitive. It's more sensitive to air. And of course, it's more sensitive to hydrogen peroxide. So superoxide dismutase, superoxide reductase do play a role. It does play a role in sensitivity of filofactor. So we ask the question, if it's more sensitive, if you put them together, what would you expect? And in this particular experiment here, perfumilus gingivalis is sensitive to oxidative stress. When you put it in the presence of filofactor, it's more resistant. However, when you put it in the presence of the mutant that is a little more sensitive to hydrogen peroxide, it does not change the sensitivity of her perfumilus gingivalis, which suggests there is something in perfumilus in filofactor that's inducing the activity, and it's not necessarily because it's more resistant or sensitive to hydrogen peroxide. Now, one of the experiments that I don't have time to show you is that we've looked at the expression profile of both filofactor and W83, perfumilus gingivalis, to see what genes are being modulated when you expose it to oxidative stress. And when you put them in co-culture, what genes are being modulated. And one of the things that we've seen is that we have some ABC transporters that are being modulated, and there are other genes associated with oxidative stress that are being modulated. Also, there are some hypothetical proteins or some hypothetical genes that are being modulated, and those we're trying to understand what role they play in allowing it to be able to survive. So when we look at community dynamics, that community dynamics sure play a role, play an important role in the survival of oxidative stress environment. And we believe that filofactor allosis may serve as an oxidative sink. One of the things it certainly can do, it can degrade or it can detoxify that oxidative stress environment. But it can also induce a relative resistant phenotype in perfumilus gingivalis. And here's a model that we're proposing that going back to colonization, where you cannot detect filofactor allosis, but it's part of the biofilm. It becomes part of the mature biofilm. And that mature biofilm, which contains filofactor allosis, it will trigger a host response. where you get these cells being produced. It can also trigger a host response where you get your macrophages that will produce your hydrogen peroxide that can impact the microbial biofilm, the mature biofilm, and it will bring about an environment that has a very high concentration. It has a very high concentration of filofactolosis. Remember I told you earlier that Paraphimolis gingivalis can also, in very low concentration, in very low abundance, can also cause damage because it can modulate this microbiome, and it can also induce an inflammatory response. In this particular case, where we have a microbiome that has a very high concentration of filofactolosis, and it may have lower concentrations of Paraphimolis gingivalis, can still impact the host, resulting in breakdown in tissue. It can also induce DNA damage. So what are the mechanisms for survival of these microbes in the host? One, it has a mechanism where it can repair DNA damage. It can also detoxify the environment. And another very important strategy is that it will interact with its neighbor. By interacting with its neighbor, namely filofactolosis, it becomes more resistant to hydrogen peroxide-induced oxidative stress. I've shown you where there are other genes that are being upregulated, and we've seen where in doing microarray and also RNA sequencing, looking at the profiling of this bacterium exposed to hydrogen peroxide, we see where a lot of different genes are modulated, and those genes, which are mostly hypothetical, most of them that we see are hypothetical, and we're in the process of trying to characterize them, does play a role, we think, in allowing it to survive in this particular environment. So to protect against oxidative stress and enhance survival, Paraphimolis gingivalis can use various mechanisms, including endogenous enzymatic and non-enzymatic antioxidants, its interaction with other bacteria, and novel yet to be described mechanisms to be able to survive oxidative stress. And I can tell you a lot over the years, and I'm quite proud, I have Dr. Johnson here who, he was one of my graduate students earlier on. He's kind of started some of this work because part of his work had to look at oxidative stress resistance. I didn't describe a lot of what he did when he was in the lab, but he started us down the path looking at oxidative stress resistance in Paraphimolis gingivalis, and we've continued that, looking at different mechanisms. And we see very unique mechanisms. We have another student from NCU, Leroy Henry, and Leroy was looking at how Paraphimolis gingivalis responded to oxidative stress, how its DNA is damaged and how that is being repaired. And he has described a novel mechanism. We're still trying to complete that work, but it's a novel mechanism that's being used to repair DNA that's damaged on the oxidative stress. So we've had a great time, and we have students from this university that has contributed to this work, helping us to understand in a comprehensive manner how this organism will respond to oxidative stress. And by looking at all these different mechanisms, of course we can extrapolate as to what other organisms might use in similar environments to respond to oxidative stress. A very complicated process, but one that's exciting that we've been engaged with over the years. And with that, I'll stop and I take questions. And this is a picture, artist rendering of what Loma Linda is going to look like in next year. Looking at our medical center, we're putting up two new hospitals. This is a adult hospital and this is a children's hospital. Quite an expansion. And of course, we're still looking for students to come to join us and to engage in this process of research. I'll stop and I take questions.
Professor Wellington to come to so that you could ask questions to Professor Wellington and Dr. Fletcher. Dr. Fletcher is no stranger to NCU, as he rightly told you early on. A number of our graduate students from Northern Caribbean University, they have done work with him in various areas. We have Washington, Daily, she has worked with Dr. Fletcher, and we have other persons who are not here now who have worked with him, and I'm quite sure there are other persons who may want to do their research at Loma Linda with Dr. Fletcher. Now, question time.
There's a question right there.
Yes.
The relationship between Philofactor and Porphyromonas gingivalis, do you believe is it a one-sided affair where Porphyromonas gingivalis gets pretty much all or most of the benefit from having Philofactor around? Is it an unwitting process where they just happen to, Porphyromonas just happens to benefit from Philofactor, or is it intentional? What are your thoughts around that?
Well, that's a great question. And I don't know the answer to that yet.
Okay.
We do know that under these conditions, Porphyromonas gingivalis seem to do a lot better than Philofactor. Well, it does a lot better with Philofactor around than by itself. Now, Philofactor is certainly it's a slow-growing organism. Now, whether it's survival, long-term survival, Porphyromonas gingivalis can help. That's still a question that I don't know. The only thing that I do know is that when Philofactor is there, Porphyromonas gingivalis seem to do better. However, when the two are together, they seem to be more virulent.
So you get
better invasion by Philofactor, and also better adherence by Philofactor when PG is there. So we could see some benefits there, but I'm not ready to mortgage the house on that yet.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Yes, my question to Dr. Fletcher is, antibiotic resistance is a very big concern. And I was very interested in the fact that you stated that, you know, the symbiotic synergies between the two organisms actually enhance their resistance to the toxicity of the peroxide. Do you think that this mechanism could also extend to the whole, you know, phenomenon of antibiotic resistance that we are observing now in a lot of microbes?
In this case, I'm not sure, because we have not looked at its level of sensitivity to antibiotics. Certainly, we know when you're treating patients with, let's even say, tetracycline or some of those antimicrobials that they use during dental procedures, seem to be quite effective. We have not yet seen any strains that have extra chromosomal DNA that will induce resistance to antibiotics. I suspect it can, but we have not seen it in this case. What we have seen is that its ability to interact with the host and to counter the host response, there's a lot of synergy. In terms of antibiotics, we have not seen that yet.
Thank you.
Any other question? Yes, Mr. Rose.
Good afternoon. My question is to Dr. Wellington. Concerning the zinc in the alumina, was the zinc harvested during that process of extracting it from the
bauxite?
The bauxite. I mean, you said you went through the process, and in the process, if you have high heat, zinc tends to go into the solution and therefore cause problems. So when you get rid of the zinc, is that zinc harvested or is it just deposited into the mud lake?
Yes, it's deposited as effluent into the mud lake. So it goes with the mud to the mud lake. It's in very low concentrations.
Yes.
And zinc is a low-cost metal, not like the high-value metals, the rare earths that might be there. But zinc is a low-cost, so not much concern for it. But it goes to the mud in concentrations of about 0.02%.
Yes, I have a question for Dr. Wellington, but it's slightly off track. With regards to bauxite mining, there are a lot of heavy metals in the mined out bauxite land, but like arsenic and so forth, and cadmium. But zinc tend to counteract cadmium. How do you relate to the level of zinc and cadmium in bauxitic soil?
They find that the karst bauxite, which is typical of the Jamaican bauxite scenario, a lot of the soluble metals are not leached out as compared to lateritic bauxites. So in our bauxite, you tend to have a lot of the soluble, more of the soluble metals in the bauxite. Cadmium levels tend to probably be found a little lower down. So after they scrape off the top to mine the bauxite, usually find at the lower levels you'd have increased cadmium levels. So the mined out lands, you probably would find higher levels of cadmium than in the topsoil. And I know some studies have been done where they found that the mined out lands, the crops grown there, tend to have very high cadmium levels. I think that's it.
Do zinc counteract cadmium?
Well, both of them are divalent ions, and so it certainly would be able to interact there. I know zinc replaces iron in goethite, and it replaces some other metals in some of the minerals that are found. So certainly, it should be able to replace cadmium because it's more reactive as a metal. Yeah.
Thank you.
Self, who is into the humanities, of what value is your phylactic, if that is what you said, not quite sure what that was. Is it that age impacts on these things? How would somebody like myself find value in what it is that you presented? Same for you, Dr. Wellington. With all that we're seeing within this bauxite land, whether it be from the cadmium or the zinc or whatever it is that you would have presented, how would that impact on our farmers? Of what value would that information be to those of us who are not scientifically minded?
Well, that certainly is a great question, which when we speak to a mixed audience, we usually try, which I tried hard, not to go into a lot of details, experimental details, just so you can get an overview of what we're trying to say. The take-home message from this is that a lot of diseases are inflammatory diseases. So when you think of periodontal disease or gum disease, it's an inflammatory disease. just like Crohn's disease, just like heart disease, just like cancer, and several of those diseases that have inflammatory components. These cells are, under these conditions, are damaged or get damaged. And how does the host respond in trying to protect itself? That's the take-home message from what we've been using. Our paradigm involves a microbe that under oxidative stress, we can determine what mechanism is being used to survive. And hence a very broad title for the topic. How do you withstand environmental stress? They all have common components. What strategy? So in this case, when you use a microbe which you can manipulate, and you see the process, at least at the molecular level, it will give you ideas of what may occur in other systems where the cells can survive. And certainly, there's a lot of experiment, a lot of data out there on how cells withstand oxidative stress. And we're trying to understand even more and what other mechanisms are out there. So yes, it's not just about the bacteria, but it's how they respond that we can extrapolate to how host cells might respond and how we can overcome some of these diseases. We can survive some of these terrible diseases that has these diseases that have these components as part of it.
Yes, for my research, I think the underlying or the overarching thing that I'd like people to leave with is the use of science to endow one with a competitive advantage, or to allow one to produce a product that is acceptable in the market. You know, science is made to solve problems. And one of the problems with our bauxite is the high zinc. The bauxite is of no use to alumina smelters if the zinc is too high. So we have to find a way to still process our bauxite in and to make it, you know, amenable or acceptable to smelters. And so we had to devise a way to reduce the zinc content of the alumina that is produced from the bauxite. And so this study really looked at strategies of that were within budget, so that your alumina is not too costly that it's out of the market, so that at least we can export the alumina and we make some foreign exchange and build up the economy. So it shows the role of science in producing answers to problems in such a way that we can make economic production and so forth from it. Yeah, good.
Good. Thanks a lot, Prof. Wellington and Prof. Fletcher, for your presentation. Could you put your hands together for them? Thank you very much. At this time, we have Professor Harris, Mark Harris, from the Department of Biology, Chemistry, and Environmental Science of Northern Caribbean University, and he will be speaking to us about bamboo. Professor Harris, he has done a lot of work on bamboo, and if you read the paper last week, they have been talking a lot about bamboo, even to use in medicine. I don't know if Professor Harris has gone down that route yet with the health aspect of bamboo. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, let us put our hands together to welcome Professor Mark Harris.
Fortunately, I need a little in-service on using this pointer. I haven't got time to really check out those buttons, so.
Okay, we're looking at cold waters. Let's go back, please. Cold water starch extracted bamboo used as banana tree braces. Implications for atmospheric carbon. Problem here, but let's look at the abstract. Sticks or bamboo for banana trees. We, in Jamaica, we use sticks to prop up banana trees when they have borne to prevent them falling over. Now, this is replicated all over the tropical world, and that's a lot of sticks. The problem with the sticks is that they decompose rather quickly, especially if they are of softwoods. And so therefore, we are looking at a kind of brace which will last a long time. And if that banana stick lasts over 2, 3, 4 years, then we will be decreasing the deforestation of the earth. Why is that important? It is because the tropical wet forests are the lungs of the earth. There's no other forest in the world outside of the tropics that is as valuable as the tropical rainforest. Why? Because these are not deciduous trees. The tropical trees are evergreens. If you look at the carbon quantities in the atmosphere outside of the tropics, after summer, after those trees have dropped their leaves, then the carbon load is much higher, significantly higher than in the tropics. So for at least half of the year, those trees without leaves are not pulling carbon from the atmosphere, whereas the evergreens, tropical evergreens, they do it every day. And furthermore, the evergreens, their leaves are bigger. All right? And therefore, we have a problem when we start to cut down our trees to decompose them and send more carbon in the atmosphere. In comes bamboo. Bamboo is not much different because bamboo decomposes just as rapid, even faster than these other trees. So why are we interested in bamboo for banana braces? And don't forget that bananas are one of the most prolific crops. So there are thousands of square miles of banana in the world. All right. Now, the bamboo has a problem because it is prone to fungal decomposition. So we have looked at a method of extracting the food of the fungus, which is starch and sugars from the bamboo. We have a problem, though. If you're going to extract starch, you have to have a way of solubilizing that starch, which we cannot do with cold water because it does not dissolve in cold water. So we had to find a way of treating that cold water to make it a solvent of starch. You're right. Okay. All right. Now, the problem with starch is that starch has two polymers. We have a pointer there yet? Is it working? Yeah. Kindly. Just giving you some exercise to walk, you know? Seem to be working. Did you turn it off? Okay, all right. Okay. Please go back one. No. I didn't do that. I just put the light on, that's all. I didn't touch any of those. This one go back. Yeah. All right. All right, here we go. Starch is insoluble in water because, you know, starch has two polymers. You know what polymers are, very large molecules, you know, linked together like chains. All right. And we have amylose and we have amylopectin. Problem, amylopectin is soluble in water.
And it's also a very big molecule. The reason it's soluble in water, even though it's such a big molecule, it's branched, you know, so it has a lot of spaces for the hydrogen bonds, for the water, charged water molecules to get in there and to wreak havoc inside there. So it has, but the problem, okay, so it has an open structure. It has an open structure there. And, you know, however, if we look at the amylose is tightly packed, linear, coiled, and amylose induces strong intramolecular hydrogen bonds. All right? So therefore, the part of starch which is amylose is very dense, you know, granular. Starch is actually a granular thing, crystalline. You can't get water in there, cold water in there very easy. Cold water, you know, does not get into these things very easily as the hot water would, right? So it discourages access to water molecules, all right? Okay. All right, structure of starch. So, all right, so there we have it. The final thing here we have, the final line there is that many hydrogen bonds form between and within the molecule of amylopectin. And therefore, it equals a drop in solubility, just like amylose, even though starch is mainly of amylopectin, which should be dissolving, but it's not. All right. So we have a problem here. So we look at our aim. Our aim is to increase the longevity of bamboo, which we want to use as tree braces. Using alcoholic alkali, and this alcoholic alkali is to dissolve and remove the non-structural starch. And we are using this because we found that it worked before, and therefore we are trying it again with the banana bamboos. This proof that it worked is found in a paper by yours truly and Kim and Kumsen in 2015. And those of you who have seen that bamboo up by the biology area, that bamboo has been there for 4 to 5 years now. And it is very strong. It's not decomposing. The starch has been removed. And that is what we are on about with the bamboo braces for banana trees. And how did that happen? We put the bamboo in an anaerobic bioreactor. All right? Soak them underwater, cover them, and allow the bamboos to ferment. When the bamboo ferments, what does it release? Organic acids. And those organic acids neutralize the alkaloids in the bamboo. At the same time, we have yeast in that mix producing what? Yeast produce alcohols. And these alcohols will combine with the alkali to dissolve the amylopectin in starch. And that's what we based our next research on. Okay. All right. Now, just to show you, to show us what's going on, over here we have the regular sticks being used for the banana, and here we have the bamboo. So that's our problem. We're deforesting. I may also say that if you look at the right-hand side, this banana tree is not a usual banana tree. This banana tree has 12 leaves, and ordinary bananas, most other bananas have 9 leaves maximum. You can count them when you go home. This has 12 leaves. And unless you have this tree is an expensive tree in Jamaica. It's called Fia. It's a new banana of a few years now, producing sometimes 15 hands. Heavy, heavy, heavy stuff. All right? And the problem with that is that these bananas, when they bear bunches going down like that, almost halfway to the ground, and they can pull the banana tree down, especially in a little wind. So this banana is being popularized in most banana growing countries now. And that is a problem, because they need strong sticks. They need bigger sticks. We're going to deforest in order to grow bananas. All right. Further, second thing, if you see this banana tree is sick. It's not a fear, obviously, because fears cannot get sick by black sigatoka, which is the disease which is affecting this, by drying up the leaves and eventually killing the banana. Notice that these leaves are dry. Why are they dry? Because they are affected by the fungus black sigatoka. It doesn't happen with the fear. They're resistant. And that's another reason why these are capturing the world right now. So this is a tank that we use in our methods. You can see that up there, we have the length of the bamboo. And this is a timber frame, blue tarpaulin. And this is like a little swimming pool. You dump the bamboos in there, fill it up, and then take that tarpaulin right over and cover it tightly to make it anaerobic. And what are the results? The longevity of the treated bamboo banana brace compared to that of the untreated samples. Months before rotting, untreated, you can see that we have what? Six to 9 months here, if that. And I'm being generous as I say that right here. Over here we have the treated ones, and that is 40 months we have here? Well, that is before the experiment was all finished, because right now they're up to 48 months, going to 50 months and going strong. So we see that the treatment is to be considered here. Okay, so our conclusion. Cold water starch dissolution extended the durability in at least a five-fold ratio. Such results promise use of the product as banana tree braces and for other uses, outdoor uses also, under conditions of rapid tropical decomposition. These things are very effective. And let me just finish off that conclusion. There should be another line. Yes, just the last page here. With banana listed among the top 12 crop plants in the world, adoption of treated bamboo tree braces on plantations promises higher rates of reforestation and substantial carbon sequestration from the atmosphere. And one of the reasons why that is so is that we are using bamboo. Look, bamboo in itself fights erosion because the bamboo roots are matted on the ground. If you notice in Jamaica, there's no other tree in Jamaica which grows in stands naturally. You have to plant them in stands. If you want to have mahogany, you have to plant every single mahogany. If you put one bamboo in this classroom and you had the soil, come here next year and the whole place is full of bamboos. Because bamboo is totally invasive. Because its roots, one root joins the other. It's like a chain link. And that also helps to restrict soil erosion. And the next thing about bamboo that is very important is that bamboo has leaves not at the top. The leaves go right down. So they're pulling carbon from the atmosphere like no other tree can do per capita. So we have a situation here where the bamboos, we make them last longer in the ground for the banana tree braces. Therefore, they are not rotting. Therefore, they are not pushing carbon into the atmosphere for 5 years. And I think that is the way that we should be going with banana tree braces. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Prof. Harris. We are going to ask you to hold a question until after the next speaker. I noticed Prof. Harris is pushing an invasive species. So when it comes on to question, we'll question him about that. Our next speaker for this half, our next speaker is from UWI, one of the famous professor, Professor Asimoto. She has a number of graduate students. And actually, I have been doing some work with her on anthracnose in yam. So, without further ado, we are going to invite Nikolai Lutos to come forward. He's going to be talking about the fight against coffee leaf rust in Jamaica.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Afternoon. Let me first start off by saying thank you for having us here. It's really, really lovely to be in a cool parish. I couldn't be in Kingston. I can't remember the last time I saw some rain, so it's very lovely to be with you here today. Today I'll be presenting on the fight against the coffee leaf rust disease in Jamaica. All right, so this is the outline of my presentation. The outline of my presentation will proceed as follows. We'll start off with an overview of coffee leaf rust. Then we look at the impact that it has on the agricultural sector. And then we look at some of the ongoing research that we're using to combat the disease. And then we finally make some concluding remarks. Ooh, perfect. Okay, so overview of the coffee leaf rust disease. Well, coffee is one of the most economically important crops in the world. At one point in time in 2013, it was of such significant value that it was only second to crude oil in terms of its commercial value. In 2013, it is estimated that the total global value of coffee exceeded $123 billion. Now, this amount of money actually provided a source of income for 125 million households, which depend on coffee as the primary source of income, which simply means that they don't have any other source of income outside of coffee. And that was estimated by the International Coffee Organization. Unfortunately, the income of a lot of these households, especially in some of the most rural and remote parts of the world, is under threat due to a disease known as the coffee leaf rust disease, which currently is the most devastating disease affecting coffee. But what exactly is the coffee leaf rust disease? Well, the coffee leaf rust disease is a fungal parasite. It's a fungal disease caused by the parasite Hemilia vastatrix. And here's actually a lovely picture of the coffee leaf rust disease, and we'll see some of it later. Now, the spores of Hemilia vastatrix actually parasitize the coffee leaf, and this actually produces the bright orange that you'll actually see in the next slide. Now, the disease, once it starts to infect the plant, what it does is that it results in a significant decrease in the productivity, and this is something we'll elaborate on further down later. Okay, wonderful. All right, so, waiting for the pointer. Oh, okay, wonderful. All right, so if you look at the picture on the left, you'll notice we have a coffee leaf right here. Now, these yellow spots that you're seeing here, it might not be so visible, but these yellow spots right here are actually what are known as lesions. Now, when the spore actually lands on the coffee leaf, what it actually does is it infects the underside of the leaf. So these yellow spots that you're seeing right here is actually a site of infection where the parasite is going and it has parasitized the leaf. Now, let's look at what happens when you have the late stage of infection. Notice that you actually see this proliferation of bright orange. Now, what is happening from over to the left right here to right here is that these spores are actually multiplying, and each lesion that you actually see will produce 250,000 spores that can actually go out and be disseminated and infect other coffee plants. But how does it really affect the plant? Well, the picture is not so clear, but if you look at it here, you'll notice we have two trees, right? I'm not so sure if you can get it focused a bit more, but the tree on the right is a healthy coffee tree, right? And notice it has all its leaves, right? Now, if you look at the tree on the left-hand side, what you'll note is that it really looks like a stick. Yeah? Now, one of the problems with the coffee leaf rust disease is that it causes defoliation. So essentially what will happen is that all of these leaves that have been infected will drop off of the plant, and then eventually the plant will die. Now, it's not necessarily so visible on this picture right here, but sometimes what you have is that when the tree is going through defoliation, you'll have the coffee berries on the tree. But the problem is that when the disease takes a hold of the plant, the coffee berries will actually not ripen. So you lose all of that coffee that you had on the tree that was actually ripening before. And hence, you can actually see the loss in productivity due to the disease. Okay. In terms of the impact that it has on the agricultural sector, during the 2012-2016 outbreak, losses of up to 50% in production were reported in some countries, especially in some of the regions in South America that produce a lot of coffee. Now, Jamaica, like many of the countries in the South American region, has been severely affected by the coffee leaf rust disease. It is estimated that at the height of the outbreak in 2013-2014, which was when we had our real last major flare-up of CLR, the Jamaican sector lost more than $1 Jamaican dollars worth of crop due to the disease. Now, unfortunately, what is happening, or what has happened in the market, is that coffee prices have actually decreased in the last 3 years. So if you look at it from a farmer's perspective, the farmer actually has to produce more coffee to get the same amount of revenue. And thus, when you look at the fact that you have a disease affecting the coffee plant, the coffee leaf rust disease is actually creating a significant risk to the economic viability of coffee farming in Jamaica. Because remember, with coffee prices going down, you actually have to produce more, but you actually have a disease that is affecting your production. And hence, CLR is actually a major risk to the economic viability of coffee farming in Jamaica. So what research is actually currently being done on the coffee leaf rust in Jamaica? Well, currently, some of the research that we are conducting, which is a part of my Enfield study, consists of two components, right? The first component of the research is a monitoring of distribution of the genotypes, which we'll elaborate further. And the second aspect of the research is more tackled towards improving farmers' ability to better manage the disease using climate data. Now, when we look at monitoring of the genotypes, previously in 2016, we did an assessment of the genetic diversity of the pathogen. And what we found was that there are 11 variants of the coffee leaf rust pathogen. Now, at the time, this was at a point in time when many farmers were actually believing that we actually had hypervirulent strains that were brought in by wind systems. So an evaluation was done of the genetic diversity, and what that revealed was that there are 11 variants of the coffee leaf rust pathogen. Now, this was done using a type of molecular marker known as microsatellite markers. Now, when that study was conducted in 2016, what we found was that the distribution of the genotype showed no geographical isolation. So what you found was that you didn't necessarily have a variant that was in Portland that was only found in Portland. You had the variants found all over, right? Wait, hold on. Play. Technical assistance? Oh, perfect. Back. All right. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, press something. don't know.
Okay. All right, so we're back on track. Wonderful. All right, so as we're talking before, as we're elaborating before, we're looking at the genetic diversity. Now, in 2016, we assessed the genetic diversity. However, one of the things we wanted to elaborate or to find out is whether or not there was a change in genetic diversity in 2018. So one of the things that we really, really wanted to answer was, you know, where and if new genotypes were emerging, because it's all good and well that we know that we have 11 variants in the country, but are new variants appearing, or are variants appearing in places that they weren't appearing before? And because of that, those burning questions, we did actually a resampling of the same exact locations that were apparent in the 2016 study in 2018. And what we found is that during the 2018 sampling, preliminary analysis using the same microsatellite markers that were developed before revealed that there was no significant change in the distribution and the number of variants of the pathogen in Jamaica. And actually on the left right here, you're seeing some of the microsatellite markers that have been amplified. This is actually what it looks like. Single bands, the bands tend to be very, very, very small because microsatellite region, as you know, as a genome is very, very small. Now, oh, and lastly, before we head off, one of the things we noted during our collection, our sample collection, was that we had a very interesting parasite known as verticillium. Now, in biology, when you have any form of pathogen, you usually have an agent that will counteract it, right? And what we found was that verticillium species was actually observed during the 2018 collection. So if you're looking right here at where this arrow is, you'll notice you're actually seeing a white fungus. So verticillium is actually a fungus that parasitizes coffeeleafera spores. So within the natural environment, you actually do have biological controls available for coffeeleafera. So this was this actually accounted for some of the difficulties we faced in characterizing some of the areas in our study. But nevertheless, we're able to actually characterize most of the locations that we had in our study. And here you're seeing verticillium again. Now, the second aspect of the research focuses on the big output, which is improving farmers' ability to tackle disease. It's all good and well that we can tell farmers how many variants there are in the country, but we have to move to a more practical approach where we can give them advice that they can use to now help tackle the disease. One of the things with the coffeeleafera disease is that the disease is very much heavily correlated with the onset of rain, or more or less it's really correlated to climatic conditions. So if you look outside right now, it's raining heavily, right? And this is actually one of the conditions that helps to favor the proliferation of the disease. What happens with the spores that we talked about earlier is that the spores will actually germinate, but the spores germinate when there's a lot of rainfall and a lot of moisture. And that is why you find the areas that produce coffee that are up in the mountains where, you know, you have a lot of rainfall tends to be very severely affected by the disease. So because we know that the climate conditions are significantly correlated to the onset of the disease, we have to include the climatic conditions in order to help to control disease effectively. So for this aspect of the study, we did actually a side-by-side comparison of two farms. So we chose two farms that were at the same location, and one of the farmers uses climate data in terms of making his agronomic decisions, while the other farmer actually doesn't use climate data at all in terms of when he makes his agronomic decisions. Now, what we found from the interviews and from the assessment of the incidence of the disease on the farm is that what we found was that the data indicated that there wasn't really much significant difference between the estimated incidence of the disease in the two farms. Nevertheless, what we realized though is that if we provide farmers with weather information, more specifically the longer term forecast, which helps them to predict events such as drought and high rainfall, that it would be extremely beneficial in terms of minimizing the adverse effect of weather conditions on coffee. So for example, case in point, in some of the remote parts of the mountain right now, you guys are experiencing rain, but they have not seen rain for months. So if we can tell our farmers that, listen, this year is going to be a year when you're going to have low rainfall, they can now say to themselves, okay, you know what? Let me buy some storage tanks of water and so on so that my coffee plants don't get negatively affected by the prolonged drought. And by that, you'd have actually put them in a position to better manage production or respond to these climatic conditions that would affect production. Secondly, the last thing and the really most important thing that we also realized from our interaction with the farmers was that the availability of funding was a major obstacle in terms of using the climatic conditions. Sometimes with farmers is that a lot of the farmers want to do the right thing, but they don't necessarily have the money to do it. We have to always remember that farming is a business, and you have to look at the business aspect of the farming. So especially when it comes down to disease control, such as applying your fungicides and so on, some of the farmers actually simply don't have the money to apply the fungicides. And because of that, you know, we can always give them climate data and say, hey, listen, now would be a good time to apply your fungicide before some rains come on. However, if they don't have the money to buy the fungicides and to pay the man to spray and mix the fungicides and the works, then we can always provide them with climate data, but they won't be able to use it. So we notice that, as always, the availability of funding is a major obstacle in terms of using climate data. So how is this research really helping the coffee sector on a whole? Well, from the genotyping data, it has really helped us to determine if rust is being spread across the parishes. So far from our preliminary analysis with the microsatellite markers, we're not seeing variants of rust show up in places where they weren't before, right? And that's actually some of our preliminary analysis. We're going to do more loci, but so far, so good, right? The next thing, And then also, this allows us to monitor the spread of the disease to new parishes. So as we said before, based on the characterization, we can now tell if there is actually a variant of the pathogen that was in Portland that has appeared in a different aspect of the country. Now, this is very, very, very important because this helps you to give information in terms of how disease is spread. So within coffee, what you find from time to time is that you'll have people who will go from one parish picking coffee to a next parish, right? And they'll actually have the same clothes and so on. And that actually creates a problem in terms of spreading disease. So you might find that sometimes somebody might spread the disease from Portland over to St. Thomas, right? And this is very, very, very common, especially in the case where you have now where St. Thomas, the coffee is actually ripening now and Portland is finished, right? So that was one of the things that we really, really wanted to be able to answer. And because we actually have genotyping, it actually allows us now to see whether or not that is a concern. So far from preliminary analysis, we're realizing that it's not a major concern as yet, and that's actually very, very good for the sector. And lastly, in terms of the output and how the research is helping farmers, is that it has shown us how or what aspect of climate data can be very useful to improving agronomic decisions. As you know, the agronomic decisions are what you do on your farm in terms of decision making, when you spray, when you fertilize, when you prune and stuff like that. That actually has a very big impact on the productivity, and it also has a very big impact on the incidence and the severity of the disease. And thus, in conclusion, from the preliminary data that we have, it indicates that there has been no change in the genetic diversity of the coffee leaf rust pathogen, which is good, right? It means that we're not having more variants being introduced from other places that we don't want, right? So that's good. And secondly, using climate data does not really appear to have a significant impact on the incidence of CLR, of coffee leaf rust disease. So whether you use climate data to make your agronomic decisions or not, not really much of a big factor from what we've seen in our study. And this is a study that has been being conducted for almost a year of consistent monitoring. And so far, we're not really seeing so much of a big difference. And lastly, as always, the availability of funds is always a major obstacle in terms of utilizing climate data. So as we said before, you know, it's all good and well that we can give this information to the farmers and tell them that they need to do this and they need to do that. However, if they don't have the money to do it, then they're just not going to do it at all, right? So when you look at the availability of the funding, you know, it's very, very important in realizing that that will dictate what the farmers do and not necessarily what science tells them to do, right? Here are my references. I'd like to acknowledge the lovely Northern Caribbean University. You've been wonderful for giving me this opportunity to present. I'd like to thank the University of West Indies, Mona, my dear professor, Professor Helen Azimoto, Dr. Cliff Riley, my advisors, Dr. Elizabeth Johnson, Prof. Mary Catherine Aim, Dr. Mal Gosha, JACRA, the Jamaica Agricultural Commodity Regulations Authority, my colleagues, the audience, Almighty God. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nwoni. And we are going to have some questions now. We ask Professor Harris to come forward. So it's time for question. I don't know, let me start out with the first question to the great professor. Now, Professor, you have just written a book on the environment. And it is regarded that the bamboo is an invasive species. As an environmentalist, why are you supporting such a plant?
The word invasive has taken a lot of bad names. You could probably say that God is invasive. Rightly so. The bamboo is invasive in Jamaica. What damage has the bamboo done to Jamaica? The important thing is to look at the benefits of the invasive species. The bamboo resists erosion. We cannot live without our soils. If you want to reforest an area, the bamboo is the fastest reforester. It's the fastest growing plant in the world. Some growing 3 feet in one night. Bamboo. 3 feet, 1 meter in one night. Some species can do that. It is up to us to monitor. If you have a child that's out of order, what do? Send them away? Send him or her away? No. But you channel the bad traits in the right direction. And that's what we need to do with bamboo. We cannot throw away bamboo. If we should destroy our bamboo, we would be counterproducing what it does, and that is stopping deforestation. So I agree that it can rapidly overtake a farmer's field. Yes, I agree with that. And that is one of the downsides. But you have to have the good and the bad in life. Thank you.
Yes.
Yes, Professor Harris, of all the species that
please give your name and say who you are.
Yes, I'm Cedric Hansen, Assistant Professor, Math and Engineering Department. Dr. Harris, of all the species of plants growing here, why did you choose bamboo above the others for a substitute for the regular acidious trees? For bracing, yeah.
It's not so much that I chose bamboo, bamboo chose itself.
Right.
Because no other plant has those qualities. And first of all, no, bamboo is the strongest, has the highest tensile strength of any living object on the earth. Stronger than steel, the tensile strength I'm saying. All right? And therefore, because of that, it can withstand the high winds that afflict so much of the tropics. You read what happened to in Africa a few days ago with that typhoon. All over the tropics we have high winds, and bamboo can withstand them. And the second thing is that the treatment could not be done on any other plant but the bamboo. You know why? Because the bamboo is hollow inside, and therefore if we should put other plants, trees, sticks, woods in that sort of treatment, you know, the treatment would not soak into them. But what we did, we reamed out the middle of the bamboos. So if you look under these treated bamboos, you can use them as a pipe. You can see right through them. So the treated water run right through. And because the bamboo shell is thin, it pervades the whole thing. And the treatment works with bamboo, could not work with other plants, all right? And so therefore, we had no choice but to choose the bamboo for this purpose.
Thank you, sir.
More questions? Yes.
Yes,
It's Max Wellington, NCU. Yes, I want to ask Mr. Lutas a question. The microsatellite differences between the CL coffee leaf rust that you looked at, fungus that you looked at, was there any morphological or other phenotypic differences that you observed between them, or even sensitivity to certain fungicides that may be different? Was the microsatellite differences you observed?
Well, first of all, let me say that that's an excellent question. One of the problems that you find sometimes, especially with plants, and let me start from the perspective of plants, is that it's very difficult to detect phenotypic features. So even to the trained eye like myself, when I go out in the field and look at coffee, it's very difficult to distinguish between cultivars. Now, when you look at the fungus itself, it's very difficult to actually distinguish between morphological features. So phenotypic features or morphological features is not necessarily a good indication of differences. And that's why we actually have to go to the molecular level. Because if you look at the phenotypic features and morphological features, it might tell you that it's the same, right? But when you look at the molecular level, it gives you a better indication of the differences that exist. So phenotypic features, it's not the most suitable tool for using to evaluate differences. So genetic differences is more preferred. It's a lot more accurate. Well, actually, we haven't started that aspect of the work, but that's actually a very, very, very good question, because at the outbreak or the height of the disease, when we had our outbreak 2013, 2014, one of the problems that a lot of farmers experienced was that some of the fungicides that they had before that were working stopped working. So as you can imagine, that sent the industry into panic. And as a matter of fact, that is how we actually have a new fungus fungicide on the market known as Opera, which is actually a combination of two fungicides with two different modes of actions. So in terms of fungicide sensitivity, we suspect that that's definitely a factor. And that's probably, that was one of the reasons why the industry has actually approved Opera as one of the newer fungicides. And it has been working. It's been working really good. So that's a very good question.
In the 90s, with coffee rust, they used to use an extract from breadfruit leaf to treat the coffee rust. What has happened to that, which was an organic treatment?
Oh, so that's actually a very good question. In terms of the organic treatments, one of the problems that you have with the organic treatments is the residual amount of it that actually stays in the plant. What we find with the coffee leaf rust disease is that the best treatment for fungicides tends to be systemic, right? So when you look at the systemics are in the plant for a longer period of time, and that gives the plant protection. When you look at areas such as the Blue Mountain that is characterized by high rainfall, you need something like a systemic that stays in the plant for a very long time. When you compare that to plant extracts, they don't really have that property. We haven't necessarily seen plant extracts that actually stay in the plant for a very long time. Because what you actually have to remember is that, you know, when it's raining or when these conditions are ripe, you'll actually have an outbreak of the disease. So if it doesn't come today, it's going to come tomorrow. And that is why it's very important in terms of the treatment regime to treat them with systemics. So we haven't necessarily seen any plant extracts that are being used right now. The main treatments that have been used are really systemic. But the breadfruit leaf extract, that has been discontinued for the most part. Prior to that was copper, but copper really has stopped working because it doesn't spend a long time in the plant. So I think if any of your researchers at NCU finds a treatment that has systemic properties, go ahead and apply it to coffee leaf rust disease.
On the matter of systemics, I'm surprised that I didn't hear any mention of mancozeb, because mancozeb is very potent against anthracnose, and mancozeb contains the damaging molecules and metals like copper and manganese for sulfhydryl points in the enzymes. It's a potent systemic, and it's potent against all kinds of anthracnose. So I'm surprised that I didn't hear that. Can you explain why that was not are featured?
That's actually a very good question. So in terms of that systemic that you have just mentioned, you have to also remember that there is regulation of the types of fungicides that you can actually use in coffee. Remember, coffee is a very much trademark product, and you have to be very careful of what fungicides you use. Based on the JACRA, Jamaica Agricultural Commodities Regulation Agencies, macrocet is not one of the systemics that they recommend. The recommended systemic at this point in time are Topsin, Opera, in terms of contact tilt to a lesser extent, but Opera is really the systemic that has been championed by the board. So in terms of macrocet, it's currently based on our experience and our interactions with farmers, we haven't actually seen any farmers that actually has used macrocet, and I haven't necessarily seen it myself on the market from the farm stores that are close to that area. But I'm glad to hear about macrocet, you know.
I'm sorry to be asking a follow-up question, but the fact that it's not seen is not an excuse. I'm not you personally, no. Not for the farmers not to use it. I think somebody needs to bring it to their attention. That's my view, because if it can, I think you're saying that it can be damaging to the fruit of the coffee. We're not interested in the coffee fruit. We're interested in coffee seed. And it's not going to affect the coffee seed itself. It's protected by the fruit. Now, the second question I have, I'm in need of some clarification of a statement that was made regarding climate predictability of weather. Now, just a couple years ago, these great meteorologists from the American sector, predicted that 3 years ago we would have a very heavy hurricane season, and we had just two hurricanes. You know, what I'm trying to say is that the state of weather prediction is still in its infancy. We cannot predict weather in advance of 3 months. We can make a guesstimate, but it's far from accurate. So what would we be telling the farmers that's going to happen to the weather in June this year? Thank you.
So that's an excellent question. Now, with climate data and weather forecast information, that's one of the main limitations, right? However, not because you have limitations means you throw something out altogether, right? As technology is really advancing, yes, we're going to become a lot better at predicting weather. However, there's a lot of times when we predict storms and so on and trajectories, and you see it a lot of times on the Meteorological Service, and these storms actually don't come to any fruition. As a matter of fact, when we talk to some of our farmers, one of the problems that we have is that they don't necessarily trust the accuracy of the data. So that is one of the concerns that we have in terms of weather data, with climate data in general. However, it's still a very much powerful tool, because when we get it right, then we can do something about it. Essentially, what you want to do is that you want to use your climate data to predict the worst case scenario so that you can prepare for it. It doesn't necessarily mean that the worst case scenario is going to happen all the time. You'd hope that it doesn't. However, the climate data really helps you to predict what would be the most likely worst case scenario so that you can prepare for it accordingly. But yes, you are very much right in saying that there are some times when you miss and sometimes you hit. But sometimes when you actually do get it right, it is very much meaningful. So, I mean, sometimes it might not work out all the times in terms of accuracy of prediction. However, when it works, it actually works beautifully.
Yes. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes. I have a question in regards to the bamboo treatment method. I saw a lot of interesting applications, because bamboo, as you mentioned, is a plant that grows very fast and is very environmentally, has very good environmental effects for its growth. And I was wondering if you've considered the wider application of bamboo treated to be to rot in a much longer period of time and being more weatherproof, for example, in outdoor furniture, construction, and other situations where people would use wood that could be replaced with this treated bamboo?
Well, actually, yes.
I've considered it. Even just yesterday, Mr. Miller from our department confronted me about it. And I use the word confronted in a very positive sense, you know, because he was really concerned. You know, he said the same thing you're saying, you know. And so many people couldn't be wrong. Now, I'm not saying 150,000 strong can't be wrong. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that from what I'm hearing, you know, people, it is a concern out there. I also heard that the Prime Minister, previous Prime Minister of Jamaica, Portia Simpson, she spoke about it also, and I think our dean here was the one she spoke to about it. So, you know, it's pervasive, the bamboo. People want to have it used. Now, yes, I have thought about it, but to be honest with you, we have to allow researchers to do research. And those who have seen the value of it, they should be the ones doing something about it. And this is a challenge I'm putting out to all those who know about the bamboo. Maybe you can write a proposal. Maybe you can make money off it, right? But it is here to stay, I believe. Thank you.
Okay, is there any more question? Oh, yes, Mr. Jones.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm sorry I missed some of the presentations. However, I do not have a question per se. If you would, I would like to share maybe some observations and some facts relating to the subject matter. Okay, well, in case of bamboo, a lot has been in the media up to very recently about investigating bamboo for housing solution. And that of itself was not new because it is done in other parts of the world, and even prior to my joining NCU decades ago, there was a national commission going towards that direction. My problem was the fact that all they were having those discussions, and I did not see where our research, that your research professor was in the mix of things. So that's a gap, maybe an information gap that needs to get to a point in place. And I have another observation in relation to coffee. Yes.
Well, I will just answer that quickly. And the short answer, I'm sorry if I have to repeat myself, but you know, I have different researches doing. I am not a money man, you know. I'm not, that's not my thing, to be going around soliciting people. I'm not a people person. I'm a research person. Thank
you understand, very much. I understand, and the observation was not leveled at you, but I think it also spoke to us as an institution per se in creating our own news, because very often science that is put out stays pretty much in science book unless somebody with funds and money want to invest and to develop the industry. But my last observation, folks, is in relation to the agriculture and the coffee roast. Agriculture is, as it were, on a research, a rebound, in terms of its contribution to our economy. But we still have some national and institutional and economic and other social problems. But sufficing to say that weather systems and weather forecasting as we have it in Jamaica on this scale of things is not good enough for agricultural purposes. Why I say that, and Professor specializes in that here, you could speak to it as well. In Jamaica, because of our mountainous terrain, we have a myriad, several microclimates, and the weather monitoring systems, we do not have enough weather stations across the island to capture enough of the microclimates that has to do with agriculture. And that is part of the root problems. Why, for example, farmers will respond differently to a number of information that it goes out. And yes, we all experience it from time to time. The weatherman, the weather forecasters, they tell you that this will be happening, and the opposite, and vice versa. But the main point is we need to have more weather stations. And I know they are expensive, etc. Automatic weather stations across the island of Jamaica to address the issue of, particularly, of agro-ecosystems. and microclimates. Would you believe it? Well, the last time I checked, there was no weather stations that govern around North Manchester, South Trelawney, where the main yam producing area is. Thank you very much.
Well, actually, that's actually a very, very good suggestion, because one of the things that you've highlighted actually is one of the barriers to effectively use the climate data. Naturally, when you have more weather stations, especially set up in certain regions where you know you have different microclimate conditions, you have a better chance of predicting, you know, the weather outcomes. So you're very much right. And as time progresses, and hopefully as funding progresses at a national level, because as you said, setting up weather stations are very, very expensive. As that actually occurs, we'll be able to put our farmers in a better position to utilize weather information, because a lot of farming depends on the weather, whether we believe it or not. So it's very important for us to really maximize, you know, the potential of weather systems. But you're right, that is actually one of the barriers in terms of overcoming and to be able to effectively use weather data.
Lastly, through the chair, may I just observe, sir, that as we look at going forward to 2030 national objectives, and we have the present generation, I'm on my way out, but one of the issues is, again, I would say a problem of so-called free market and capitalism, because if more farmers would get together and organize themselves, and so that there's particular ways of marketing, you know, in an equitable way, because I talk about capitalism, right? There could be better structures and systems in place to address some of the very problems that were identified. Because we could have, for example, a crop lane program where the farmers would, when they come to, you know, like, applying, getting the requisite technical inputs, they do that and they sell. And that's why some of the commodity boards were established in the very beginning. But, well, over time, things have changed. Thank you very much for listening to me. I will not badger you here anymore, but that's my observation.
Thanks for your questions. Thanks, Professor. Thank you very much. We have three more presentations. One of our presenter had an emergency, and she had to leave. One person never showed up. The other person is on his way from the airport, so it would appear as if this is the last presentation in this session for this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, let us put our hands together for all the presenters for this session. I think they were very good. And as I said early on, agriculture and the environment, they are of paramount importance to our survival on this planet. So we have to place more focus in terms of research in these areas. Huh? What is that? Yes, tomorrow we are going to be having some very interesting session. And if you just look in your brochures here, we have a number of sessions in the science area. We have public health. That is going to be chaired by and this is going to be in the Michaels, that is over by the nursing school. This is going to be chaired by Dr. Sona Copeland. We are also going to be having in the afternoon a health and nutrition seminar. This is going to be chaired by Professor Eric Robinson Sturridge. And there are other sessions following that. So I'm going to ask you to try to visit us many of these sessions, especially the student, and I would strongly suggest that the lecturers, you critique some of these presentations and take them to your lecturers. I have been asked by a professor from another university to grade the students who did presentation here today. So I am not going to say anything much more about those. So these presentations, they are very, very, very important. Very, very important. Let us try to get as much as possible out of these presentations. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you for coming. I want to thank you for your question. And I hope you will have a very enjoyable evening, but we cannot leave here without not praying. And I'm going to ask somebody from the science department to close us off with prayer. And I'm going to ask Professor Giles. He's from the science department. No matter where he goes, to, he's going to come right back.
Yes, man, they need to know it. Hello, I invite everybody to stand for the alma mater, to the Blessed Hill. Yes, man. To the Blessed Hill. Yes, man. Almighty God of heaven, we're just thankful for the time spent from morning until now. We're asking thee to be with us as we depart and as we prepare